motivating force, Dr. S.C. Manjanda. He is former head of cardiology, All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Motivation force because his thought processes away from medicine for non-medical efforts or interventions for medical treatment. So I had a chance to meet him last time, and he conducted a yoga class there. We conducted it this time in Bathinda. So I invite Dr. S.C. Manchanda to talk about yoga and medicine, which will be, I think, is a landmark in our scientific program to have Dr. S.C. Manchanda amongst us. Thank you, sir.
My friends, at the outset, I wish to record my sincere appreciation to Dr. Vithal Gupta and the organizers for having invited me to this beautiful conference, which I think is unique. As he said, MEPICON had the yoga session for the first time, and he is such a good faculty in such a beautiful city. It's so peaceful as compared to Delhi, which is full of hustle and bustle. Well, I'm going to talk about a subject which has not come in the mainstream of medicine as yet, but I think it is coming rapidly, and our future generation will have to, I think, deal with this also. Most of us do not know what yoga is and what are its applications. Although we know that yoga is becoming popular all over the world now. Our Prime Minister, 4 years back, in front of the General Assembly, got International Day of Yoga on 21st June approved. And from that time, every country in the world is doing yoga. Whether Western countries, Eastern countries, Gulf countries, all of them are doing it. It's becoming very, very popular because of its health benefits. But I must say the medical profession does not know what firstly yoga is and what are its health benefits. I'll try to summarize some of them, which is all evidence based. Although yoga is a very old discipline, but you can see these are the publications that we had. The doctors were really very much behind. It's only in the last few years that the publications have really increased, and these publications have covered almost all the systems, from musculoskeletal system, cardiovascular, maximum respiratory, and so on. And it's also very heartening. Initial studies were non-randomized. Now you are getting more and more randomized studies. So I think it is rapidly coming into the mainstream, and even large multi-central trials are being done in which India is taking the lead. That's a great thing as far as yoga is concerned. Now, what is yoga? I think yoga is the biggest gift of India to the rest of the world, because this originated in India about 5,000 years earlier, even much earlier than that. But Acharya Patanjali, summarized it in so-called Yoga Sutras in 5,000 years earlier. And what he said was that it is a process of balancing the mind. It's the mind which becomes serene and peaceful and all. So I think Patanjali described this, and this is a great contribution to the rest of the world, because the rest of the world is doing more than what India is doing now. But what is yoga actually, in simple terms, if you have to really define it? When I started, I have been doing research in yoga for the last 25 years. When I started yoga research, my patients said they are elderly people with coronary artery disease. Doctor, we cannot do yoga. It's very complicated asanas. We can't stand on the head, etc. So I must tell you here, yoga is not merely a few postures, but a complete way of life. It is possibly the best lifestyle ever devised, as I will show you that it is a lifestyle. Yoga is a practical universal discipline, irrespective of culture, nationality, race, caste, creed, sex, age and physical condition. Even people who cannot sit on the floor can do it. Chair yoga is there. Even people who cannot sit on the floor can do it while lying down, because it's a state of mind which makes you peaceful. So anybody can do it, and that's why it's accepted all over the world. Nothing to do with any religion, etc. It's not a physical exercise also. What does yoga aim? It aims at harmonious development of body, mind. This is important. The mind is missing from our science, medical science, for a long period of time. It leads to physical well-being, mental harmony, culminating in positive thinking, happiness and peace. That is the ultimate aim of life. We want to be happy, we want to be peaceful, we want to be positive. Actually, yoga is a lifestyle which consists of four things, that is physical, mental, emotional and spiritual. The physical component of yoga is that diet is a part of yoga, sattvic diet. And as you heard just now, that it is the mycobacteria which is very important for causation of almost every disease, including cardiovascular. It's coming up. So diet has a big role in the causation of any disease, and it changes the mycobacteria. A sattvic diet, which is a vegetarian diet, proven to be beneficial, low fat, and natural diet, the refined and the processed foods are not given in yoga, and these are the causes of all. So diet is a part of, physical exercise is a part of yoga. Yoga itself is a physical exercise, a mild exercise. If you do it a little more advanced, then it becomes a moderate to even severe exercise. So exercise benefits, we know that. And of course, yoga is does not advocate taking any tobacco or alcohol. So even if people who are addicted to tobacco, alcohol, can be de-addicted to this. So the physical part, I think we all agree that we should take healthy diet, we should do exercise, we should not take any tobacco. But the mental component is very important. That is, it achieves through meditation. Stress management, there are thousands of papers available that meditation can achieve the stress. It can reduce the stress and the stress management techniques and all that thing. And emotional well-being is a very important part which we really ignore. That is, all bad emotions like anger, ego, jealousy, hostility, etc. can cause a disease. We know that in cardiology, anger can cause even ventricular fibrillation, ectopics, etc. And there's a lot of data that there are many diseases which are emotional diseases. I wish there was a chapter on emotional diseases, because all these emotions have been shown to cause these diseases. And positive emotions can decrease, like compassion, love, and empathy, etc. And spiritual part is the fourth part, which believes in faith and moral value. There's a lot of data now coming. People who are spiritual, they have less disease. There was a study, meta-analysis done in the United States, more than 100,000 people who were going to the temple or going to the church, and they had longer life. 8 years they lived longer, and they has less disease, 25% less cardiovascular disease, and the recovery was much better. If they got the disease, they will get better. So it is a holistic method of lifestyle which consists of physical, mental, emotional, spiritual. And as you know, the definition of health is not mere absence of disease or infirmity. It's a state of physical, mental, social and spiritual well-being. Well, this is exactly what yoga can achieve. There's a lot of confusion which yoga to do. There are a large number of yogic people available all over the world. They have all been, you see, designed on these eight disciplines of yoga. This is a eight-stepped discipline which was described by Patanjali 5,000 years earlier. The first two steps are yam, niyam. These are some personal and social norms which you have to remain clean, truth and so on and so forth. Then of course are the asanas or postures. Any comfortable posture, sitting straight with the spine is also a comfortable posture. You need not do complicated. So first part is the asanas. The second is the pranayama, that is the breathing control. Normally, as we were telling in the morning, that we breathe rather 18 to 20 times. If we bring down the breath, there is a mental peace. And secondly, we advise abdominal breathing. That means when we breathe in, abdomen should come out. Abdominal breathing has been shown to increase the vital capacity by 20 to 30%. So pranayama itself can cause a lot of relief, and there are a lot of studies available only on pranayama. And then there is the third, is the meditation, the seventh step, which is achieved by control of senses and concentration. And so these are the three essential. That is, you have to have some posture, stretching posture. There are studies done from Harvard Medical School. Benson is known for that. Even stretching can itself cause definite relaxation. Now studies on breathing, which can relieve, and meditation, of course, there are a huge number of studies. Meditation is not difficult. You can do it even sitting on a chair, as it's called chair meditation, chair yoga. So yoga can be done any one of them. Now there are some people who talk more of asanas, for example, Iyengar yoga. Of course, they talk of other things also. Some people talk more of breathing, for example, Ramdev and Shri Shri Ravi Shankar. And there are people who talk only of meditation, transcendental meditation, Raj Yoga is there, Brahma Kumaris. And the most popular these days is mindfulness meditation, which is the Buddhist system. I think all these systems have been shown to be beneficial. So what is yoga then? In a very simple term, it's nothing but a holistic and intensive lifestyle modification consisting of stress management, which is not there in any lifestyle that I know of, healthy diet, regular physical exercise, and avoidance of tobacco. I termed this long back as a lifestyle polypill. You know, there's a pharmacological polypill which is available for cardiologists. They have combination of antihypertensive statins and so on. But that lifestyle polypill does not look after many other factors like stress, like smoking. But this can look after all of them, and there's no side effect of this polypill. Now, what are the potentials of yoga? It has been shown to be have beneficial in all the three aspects of health. Promotive health promotion is extremely good. If you are healthy, it makes you a better human being, a more healthy. So that's why it's been used for wellness and all these wellness clinics, etc. But prophylaxis, prevention, is the main rule of yoga, and it is beneficial for primordial prevention, which I think is the best, than primary prevention and secondary prevention. I'll show you some evidence that how is it useful for that. And it can be even therapeutic also. And there is data to show that diseases in early stages can be controlled just by yoga. You don't need any. These are the physical benefits. The physical benefit, it's created a toned, flexible and strong body in order to improve respiration, energy and vitality. It helps to maintain a balanced metabolism, promotes cardio and circulatory health, and relieves pain. It also helps you to feel younger. Mental benefits are, these are some of these things which are mentioned in the literature. I'll show you the evidence also. Yoga helps you to relax and handle stressful situations more easily. It teaches you how to quieten the mind so that you can focus on energy. Yoga encourages positive thoughts and self-expectance. And spiritual benefits. We don't know much of spirituality, but this is a branch of science which is available in United States. Several universities are giving on spiritual medicine and all, because it seems that spirituality can also heal. What is spirituality? Yoga builds awareness of your body, your feelings, the world around you, and the needs of others. It promotes an interdependence between mind, body, and spirit, and helps you to live the concept of oneness. This is important. It gives you interdependence of body, mind and spirit. Body we know quite a lot, medical science people, but we don't know much about the mind. We don't know anything about the spirit or the consciousness, and I think the research should be done in that. Now these are the scientific, which is published articles, huge number of articles are there, and I will refer you to a book by Satbir Khalsa. He is a physiologist in Harvard Medical School. This is published from Boston, Principles and Practices of Yoga Practice in Healthcare. And this is a beautiful book. It summarizes all the advances, all the published literature in this field. And according to that book, there are several conditions which is beneficial, like mental health conditions, for example, depression, anxiety, insomnia, ADHD, and addiction. And there, one study from India has shown it is as good as antidepressant drugs without any side effects. Musculoskeletal conditions have been used in low backache. There's number of articles now, arthritis, and especially fibromyalgia, which is a very difficult condition to treat. And of course, headache. A recent study from All India Institute has really shown that it's extremely good for migraine. In diabetes mellitus, huge number of articles are there, and I will talk about them. Metabolic syndrome, heart disease, of course, the largest data is in heart disease patients, like coronary artery disease, which I have been doing some research in, hypertension, heart failure, even arrhythmias. So every part of heart disease it can look after. Respiratory diseases, of course, in bronchial asthma, there are a number of articles, and similarly, chronic obstructive airway disease. Gastrointestinal diseases, there are a number of gastroenterologists here. Our colleagues from All India Institute have also, Dr. Deepak has shown. In irritable bowel syndrome, ulcerative colitis, similarly, there are several studies in constipation and so on. Cancer, of course, cancer killing cells have been shown to be increased during yoga, but it has been shown that during chemotherapy, if one does yoga, the side effects are much less. And in survivors, it has a positive outlook. Pediatric, geriatric, obstetric and gynecology, and wellness and positive health. There are so many of them, but I will not be able to discuss all of them. I will talk about in context of non-communicable diseases. The interest in yoga has really increased because we have not been able to tackle non-communicable diseases at all, in spite of the fact we have done so much of research, so much of advancement in conditions like diabetes, heart. We can even replace a heart, but look at the occurrence of these diseases, we have not been able to tackle at all. So these are the leading killer of mankind now. 70% even in our country, is like heart disease, diabetes and so on. And that's why the interest came, whether because we have failed, the medical science has failed to tackle these diseases. And why have we failed? Have we ever given introspection? Why lifestyle diseases are increasing in spite of improved knowledge? People know what is a good food. People know exercise is good. Earlier the knowledge was not there. The reason is these are so-called non-communicable, are called lifestyle disease. Lifestyle is a complex phenomena in which lifestyle choices like diet, exercise, smoking and mind-body interaction, including behavior and stress, are prominent. Unless we change the behavior of an individual, I don't think we can improve these, because patients know, people know that exercise is good, they don't do exercise. Hardly, I think, 5% of the urban people are doing exercise in my colony where I stay. They're not more than 5% are regular. The reason is because the behavior has not been changed. And there is a strong mind-body relationship, because behavior is mind-body interaction. Unless we control the mind, we will not be able to change the behavior. So, and everybody knows there's a strong mind-body relationship. Disturbance in the mind, which cause stress, can contribute to the causation of this disease. Hence, holistic and mind-body technique like yoga may be useful. And this is a cartoon taken from one of these books, that there is a strong mind-body and mind-heart relationship. A healthy mind causes a healthy heart and a healthy body, and vice versa. So this relationship is very well known. There are complex neurohormonal chemicals which are involved in this, but everybody knows there is a strong mind-body relationship. As is the mind, so is the body, and as is the body, so is the mind. So disturbance in the mind contributes significantly to the causation of several diseases. Unless this inner conflict is healed, the outer cure cannot be total and permanent. This is given even in Gita. Now, how does stress cause this disease? Now, it has been studied. A new science has come, which is called psychoneuroimmunobiology, in which the psycho means the stress, the disturbance in the mind can cause, of course, stress. It can cause happiness also. Once stress is caused, it acts via the brain. Hypophysis, pituitary, adrenal axis is stimulated, and it also changes the sympathetic nervous system, the sympathetic and parasympathetic. The moment hypothalamic pituitary system is involved, you can see a large number of hormones are liberated, and they act in a interactive way, complicated way. Ultimately, they can change the behavior. They can cause immunosuppression, inflammation, ultimately cause heart disease, diabetes, and even arrhythmias and heart failure. So what is the evidence? There is strong evidence in psychosocial stress that yoga can reduce stress and lead to improvement in both cardiovascular response and recovery from stress. Several randomized, and there's a huge meta-analysis done, and several studies now have suggested that yoga is extremely beneficial in controlling anxiety, depression and psychosocial stress. Therefore, yoga has been extensively used as an effective technique for stress management. And the mechanism has also been studied, that during yoga, the neurotransmitters in the brain like serotonin and GABA, etc., are increased, and there's a decreased sympathetic activity. This is exactly what, like most of the antidepressant drugs and so on and so forth. So there is a consistent opinion in hundreds of studies that psychosocial stress, especially anxiety, depression, could be reduced. I will be talking in relation to cardiovascular system, because it's not possible to cover the rest. I think every specialist can really take part into that. You see, cardiovascular disease can be considered as a continuum. It starts with some risk factors like dyslipidemia, hypertension, diabetes, smoking, and then it leads to something called oxidative stress and inflammation. Endothelial dysfunction also occurs, which leads to atherosclerosis. It's complicated, I'm making it very simple, it's a cartoon, which can be early atherosclerosis and it can be advanced, which causes ischemia and myocardial infarction, which can lead to arrhythmias, heart failure, and so on. It can cause death. And yoga is unique that it can act at almost all levels, starting from the risk factors to the all the secondary prevention, including arrhythmias, and I will show you some evidence which is there. Now this is the data on hypertension. There are more than 1,000 studies available. These are randomized controlled studies in this chart, and you can see these are about 10,000 patients, and this is a meta-analysis of some of the trials which are available there. And it has been shown in majority of the trials there is a modest decrease in blood pressure. Although the decrease is modest, 5 to 10 millimeters systolic, and diastolic is about 4 to 6 millimeters, but this is significant in the population. If you could reduce this, this will have more effect than treating all patients of hypertension. It will decrease so many strokes that all the antihypertensives, it will decrease myocardial infarction. So if everybody does yoga, I think the rates of these complications like strokes and myocardial infarction will come down significantly. Although it is a, the effect is so much that the American Heart scientific statement, this was a supplement which came in 2013, first published in Hypertension, and they titled it Beyond Medications and Diet, Alternative Approaches to Lowering Blood Pressure. And this was a scientific statement. They went through the literature to see yoga and meditation and came to the conclusion that meditation has moderate effect on lowering blood pressure, although the indication was rather poor. 2B level of evidence was only B. It's considered as a weak, but I think the data is increasing now. This was 2013. So it was a consensus of this group, even at that time, that it is reasonable to use all individuals with blood pressure levels more than 120/80 to consider meditation as an adjuvant method. So they have suggested that in pre-hypertension, you could use this. We also did one study in with ambulatory blood pressure, and we found that in pre-hypertension, that the blood pressure does come down. As you know, pre-hypertension also leads to hypertension 50%. And not only that, the early morning surge is significantly reduced and all. So more studies are needed with ambulatory blood pressure, because we have so many syndromes of ambulatory. We have early dippers, non-dippers, we have fast hypertension. I think the studies need to be done with this, and this is an open field, but it has already come into the scientific statement of American Heart Association. What about diabetes? Again, a large number of studies are there, although the number is much smaller than hypertension. And most of the studies, out of 24 randomized controlled study, 22 have shown that there is a decrease in HbA1c, almost as much as the metformin does, without any side effects of 0.5 to 1% decrease in HbA1 has been seen. And even lately, this year, the American Diabetic Association, the best paper was from India on diabetes, and this is a one of the best papers that we can think of, done from Dr. Nagendra from Bangalore, that diabetes prevention through yoga-based lifestyle, a pan-India study, randomized control study. And this was a huge study of about 3,400 pre-diabetic patients. Yoga intervention was given, and it was found that 47% of the diabetes could be reduced. So yoga can reduce diabetes incidence as much as 47%, and this paper was awarded. So it's coming into the limelight. Most of the conferences now, even American conferences, are recognizing this thing. Of course, this was a short-term study, 3 months and all, but this is very significant that diabetes could be prevented by this. In obesity also, there are studies, I'm not going to detail, small number of studies are there, and they have shown consistently decrease. A huge study has been done recently from Ramdev Center. Dr. Shirley Tallis is a very good scientist. She has done a randomized controlled trial in 10,000, it's under publication, and shown that with the same diet, same calories, you can reduce, and she has studied the biochemical aspect. So this is again a huge study which is going to be reported soon, which has shown that the central obesity as well as the overall obesity could be reduced through BM. She has done a lot of biochemical, leptin, etc., and I think that will be published again. In metabolic syndrome, which is a very common disease, again it has been shown to be beneficial. I'm not going into details. And even smoking cessation, which is a very difficult thing, yoga has been used, and some small studies are there. It could be useful. Even in lipid profile, independently of the diet, etc., it has been shown that it could decrease modestly LDL, triglycerides, and increase HDL. Again, the number of studies are too small. We have utilized this for reversal of heart disease also. And you know, this is a condition very common, metabolic syndrome. And this was, we took 100 patients. Half of them we gave yoga and half of them the usual treatment, and studied them after 1 year. And what we found was the carotid intimal medial thickness was significantly reduced in the yoga group, indicating that early atherosclerosis can be reversed. So if early atherosclerosis is there, which does not manifest in the coronary, but carotid intimal medial thickness, this yoga could be helpful. In addition, there was significant decrease in the other parameters of metabolic syndrome, like BMI, the waist circumference, the HDL, LDL, and systolic blood pressure, all were decreased. Similarly, others have shown that insulin sensitivity could be changed by yoga. The number of studies are there. Even advanced atherosclerosis could be regressed. And we did this study in 2000. Before that, Dean Ornish had done it, and Raj Yoga trial. All of them have consistent results. Although lifestyle heart trial was done in patients who had less than 40% stenosis, we did more than 70, and Raj Yoga trial also did more than 70. Different methodologies, because Raj Yoga trial only used meditation, we used all the three limbs, that is the asanas, breathing and all, and lifestyle heart also used another method. So all of them showed consistent, these are all randomized control with coronary angiography. Unfortunately, they are not with intravascular ultrasound, which is the gold standard, but I'm sure it will be done later. BMI decrease in all these studies. The lipids came down. These studies were done before the statins were routinely practiced. They were not in practice. So they did decrease markedly, and as I was saying, you LDL as well as the triglycerin. Angina was markedly reduced, and also objective tests like thallium and TMT was also improved in large number of patients, and we could see the regression. It was small. 5% decrease, but the events were markedly reduced, as you will see that possibly we changed the morphology of the plaque from unstable to stable. So regression, I think, is a wrong word. It should be called as the alteration of the plaque, because the hard plaques don't cause myocardial infarction. Psychosocial status was improved, and the compliance, this is a very important part, was more than 80%. You see, as I said, people do not follow the lifestyle, they don't follow the diet, they don't follow the exercise, and they don't follow even the drugs. But we found here the compliance was more than 80% to 90% in all these three studies. So I think this might be changing the behavior, and that's why. This was a short-term study of 1 year. What about long-term studies? And this is one study from the United States which was published in Circulation, only one study. This is a 9 years follow of meditation, which is a part of yoga. And it showed that patients of coronary artery disease at 9 years, the average follow was 5.4 years, they had a decrease by 48% of the hard events like non-fatal MI, stroke, and death. So it is possible, more studies of course are needed, that yoga, if you add with the conventional secondary prevention, it could decrease the mortality further, and there is evidence for this. What about arrhythmias, which are very common again? In the general population, atrial fibrillation is the commonest arrhythmia, and this was published in JACC. Again, the leading journals are publishing a study from United States, again by Dr. Lucky Reddy, who is an electrophysiologist, and he showed that practice of yoga can decrease atrial fibrillation, both the manifest as well as the symptomatic as well as the non-symptomatic effects. Of course, similar effects have been shown in ventricular ectopics, even patients who have ICD. Their shocks have been shown to be reduced, because patients of ICD are having a lot of anxiety, depression, and that can cause. After it has been used for cardiac rehabilitation after coronary bypass surgery, 250 patients after bypass surgery. Half of them were given yoga, and they were shown that there was